So coming all the way from Moscow is Lana Sator right now. She's an explorer of all sorts of completely amazing, mind-blowing, old Russian ex-USSR industry. And she's going to talk about the size, and she's going to show some pictures which give you an idea of how large and amazing those factories are, and how you can explore them, and what her story is, basically. So please all welcome Lana Sator.
Hi, everyone. I'd love to tell you about some abandoned facilities, science facilities, and industries in Russia. There are a lot of them, and I hope that you like my speech. It's well known at what pace Soviet science and the industry developed during the so-called Cold War. The arms race, the desire to establish themselves as a position of a superpower, and the application of advanced technologies in support of a powerful research and the experiment base couldn't fail the breakthrough of various industries. The progress of armed forces are different scientific achievements. But when the great era of the Soviet Union came to its end, many results of the progress appeared outside of direction and further development, and some of the achievements were sacrificed to foreign policy, the economic problems, and other planes of the state. Oh, where is... Oh. I have prepared for you an illustrated conversation in which I'm going to talk about the destruction of the Soviet large-scale projects, unfinished construction sites and factories shut down, decommissioned military complexes, and forgotten research laboratories. Not all of them ceased to exist directly after the collapse of the Union. Some of them are continuing dying today. The first theme I'm going to show to you is military projects. There are a lot of military objects that became abandoned in Russia after the USSR collapse. The first thing I'm going to tell you about is a rebel missile system. It was a great missile system that some trains were going around the country, and a rebel missile system, Molodets. It was called Molodets. It's a Russian name for this complex. It was a strategic mobile rail-based missile complex that used Soviet and conventional ballistic missiles, RT-23. These trains looked like an usual train that included some passengers, mail, and refrigerator cars, rail cars. But three of these refrigerators contained three missile launchers. There were 12 such trains that could move all over the country, waiting for a signal for battle. It took about 3 minutes from receiving the command of the general staff to missile launch. Thanks to the stockpile, onboard system may work autonomously in up to 28 days. Oh, look at this. It's a wagon launcher. A wagon launcher equipped with an opening roof and device for removing a contact network. Weight of the rocket was about 404 tons. With launch canister, its weight was 126 tons. It had firing range about 10,002 kilometers and 100 kilometers. To solve the problem of starting the car, overdrive use special landing devices that redistributes some of the weight to neighbor cars. They were located in the bottom of the rail cars. The missiles could be launched from any point of the road. The train stops and the special device put aside and shows to ground contact network. Launch canister takes a vertical position. Thereafter, the motor missile can be done. Already in the air, missile deviates using powder accelerator, and only the booster starts. The deviation allowed the missiles take the jet propulsion engine aside from starting complex, and the railway line avoids its damage. Each of three launchers included in Bezherka, it's a Russian name for rail battle complex. Maybe launch as part of the train and as themselves alone. But it was started. It was ordered on the establishment of a railway running combat missile system with the launch of the RT-23. It was signed on 13 January of 1969. Flight tests of the missile PT-23 UTTH were made on 1985 till 1987 at the Cosmodrome Plesetsk. The first missile regiment with rocket stood on duty in October of 1987, and in mid-1988 was deployed five regiments. By 1991, there were three missile divisions armed with ICBMs. But after the leaders of the USSR and the United Kingdom meet in 1991, restrictions were placed on patrol routes in Bezherka. They carried on combat duty in place of permanent deployment without going out to the railway network of the country. According to start statement, 1993, Russia was supposed to retire all missiles until 2003. At the time of removal from service in Russia, there were 12 trains with 36 launchers. Despite Russia's withdrawal from the start second, 13, 2002, during the 2003 and 2006 period, all trains and lodges were disposed, except two of them. They were demilitarized and established in, as exhibits at the Museum of Railway Equipment and Warsaw Train Station and St. Petersburg and the Technical Museum and after was. What about the bases nowadays? They got totally abandoned. There were three great bases in Kostroma, Perm, and Krasnoyarsk. I have visited only the Kostroma base. It's a great territory with a lot of railways, but it's totally abandoned, and the military forces had left it. It's destroyed, it's totally destroyed. There are a lot of buildings that had different missions for the base, but now they are desolated, totally desolated, and some of them are demolished. The hangars for the trains are emptied, and the trains will never enter them. The buildings for the soldiers are totally deserted, and the Soviet and now Russian military forces are going to renew the railway missile system, but they don't know when will it be realized. The next part of my speech is about combat chronoplans. It's a great page of our history, our military history. It has great years for be told about. A chronoplan is a high-speed vehicle machine flying the limits of aerodynamic screen. It flies in high about from a few to about 10 meters. That is relatively small altitude from the surface of water, land, snow, or ice. With equal weight and speed, with the area of the chronoplan is much smaller than the plans. You may think about the plans. They fly at a high altitude, but chronoplans can use the altitude of about a few meters above the water. It makes them not seen by radars of other countries. With equal weight and speed, wind area of a chronoplan is much smaller than the planes. On international classification, they are seagoing vessels, so they are seas for international, but in real, they are planes, but they fly only above the water. Design and the construction of chronoplans grew rapidly in the post-war Soviet Union thanks to the development of ingenious engineer Rostislav Alexeyev. In 1964 and 65, it was carried out the design and the creation of unique, the largest at the time in the world aircraft, Airplan KM. For the foreign intelligence, it was known as Caspian Monster. The Americans have deciphered the letters KM, Crabble Maquette, ship layout on its board. On the 22 June of 1966, KM was launched. However, during test flights in 1980, it crashed and sank in the waters of Caspian Sea. In 1972 was built the first real working military cranoplan Orlenok, that means an eaglet, designed to transport amphibious landings at the range of 1,500 kilometers. They were built five cranoplans type Orlenok. They all joined the Navy Aviation, and on this basis were formed 11 separate wing direct subordination of the General Staff of the Naval Aviation. Orlenky could go up the airplane mounts to a height of up 2 kilometers. According to some reports, the state program included the construction of 24 ecranoplans type of Orlenok, but these plans were not designed to become. After the death of Defense Minister Dmitry Ustinov, who oversaw high-tech weaponry, all work on the production of developments of this permission transport was stopped. Made for copies of Orlenok to 2007 war in varying degrees of cannibalization on the Navy base in Kaspisk. In June 2007, most surviving copy was towed along the Volga to Moscow and installed in the Museum of the Navy. But in 1987, first flew combat winged bomber Lunj. It was armed with six guided anti-ships missiles called Mosquito. After successful completion of state tests, Lunj was in 1919 transferred to the trial operation. However, the collapse of the Soviet Union led to the creation of work in this direction and the disbandment of the 11th Air Group Ukraine Plans Black Sea Fleet. Now Lunj is actually abandoned in dark dock of Caspian plant Duck Diesel. And its younger brother was also pawned as missile, but the collapse of the Soviet Union had a negative impact on the financing of the military-industrial complex, resulting in the completion of its construction was planned as a search and rescue vessel named Spasatel, means rescue. Spasatel was going to have a hospital on board capable to accept 150 victims and an emergency it could take up 5,000 people on board. Work on the project in the 1990s years were frozen and 95% degrees of readiness of the vessel. And now it's waiting for something, at Krasnosomovo plant in Nizhny Novgorod. It's located in one of the shops of the Greek plant. It's not easy to see it at the territory of this plant. It could become a flying hospital, but no one is going to finish its construction. The second theme of my talk is Dunai radar stations. I'm sorry for my Finnish about the Ukraine plans. But Dunai is an interesting radar stations of USSR. Dunai radar, it was called cat house or dog house by NATO, was a system of three Soviet radars used to detect American ballistic missiles fired at Moscow. They were part of the A-35 anti-ballistic missile system. The second Dunai was a prototype built in Sarishagan as part of the experimental missile defense. It was system A. It consisted of separate transmitter and receiver complexes, separated by 1 kilometer. The power of the radar was 100 kilowatts, and its range was 1,200 kilometers. The NATO code name was Hen Roost. The Dunai 3, the third Dunai, the NATO name was Dohaus, was an upgrade of the Dunai 2nd, located in Kubinka, Moscow, and became operational in 1968. Following an extensive upgrade in 1978, it was renamed Dunai 3M as part of the upgraded A-35 ABM system. It consists of separate receive and transmitter buildings separated by 2.5 kilometers. The transmitter covered 2 sectors, roughly north and south, and its array was 200 meters long and 30 meters high. Now, the power of each sector was about 3 megawatts. The receiver was building 100 meters and 100 meters high, containing 2 passive electronically scanned array radars, as well as the command and control center for the A-35 system. The range of the system was 2,500 kilometers. The Dunai 3U version of Dunai, it was called by NATO cat house, was built in 1978 as part of the upgraded A-35M anti-ballistic missile system. It's located in Chekhov. It was located in Chekhov and was structurally similar to the Dunai 3M. It has a separate receiver and transmitter, separated by 700 meters. There are 2 sectors. It was capable of identifying the launch of person-to-machine missiles from West Germany. In 1995, A-35M was replaced by the A-135 anti-ballistic missile system, which used the dawn-to-end radar. the Dunai 3U was commanded in May 1978 with a life of 12 years. Both sectors were extended until 2000, but one sector was decommissioned in 1998. The other one has been extended in 2001. And 2005, the last extension was until December 2008, but it may have been extended again. But for the story, in 2012, the Russian Ministry of Defense issued a tender for the demolition of this great complex. The demolition looked like this. You may see the photo. It was inside of the radar. Nothing of this will longer exist. It could be a great museum of Soviet force, but it will be demolished. The third theme of my speech will be disposal of military machinery. A huge amount of military equipment manufactured in the Soviet Union turned to be unnecessary in modern reality. Now we can see such rusty mortars. We have a lot of such areas full of such rusty machines, destroyed tanks, or some other military things. Also, we can see almost new missiles and containers near Moscow or in Moscow region. I have never been to some other regions except Moscow region, but I think that Moscow region is enough to see. And some of the missiles lie without any boxes in our forests. I hope that progress is more precious than all of these victims. Yeah. What do we see in industries? I hope you won't think that all of our Russian industries are in such condition. look, this is a roof of some industry in Nizhny Novgorod. The first part of my talk for industries is chemical industry. It has a great count of plants and factories all over our country. But today, foreign industries are more modern than ours. I'd love to tell you about chemical industry began to develop in the distant pre-revolutionary times. But in the Soviet years, each of its sectors experienced significant breakthrough. A number of chemical plants across the country grew rapidly. They appear in regions close to manufacturers of raw, near consumers, other factories or big cities. But in the post-Soviet era, import outpaced domestic production, and overall progress leads to the industry merge, abolished lost customers. As a result, a number of large enterprises and the prices is aside from the economic benefits. Let's consider the implications of such progress on the example of Dzerzhinsk, one of the major centers of the Soviet chemical industry. Dzerzhinsk is a small town near Nizhny Novgorod. It's about 400 kilometers from Moscow. It used to be a chemical center of our industry. There were tram roads connecting residential areas with industrial areas. Almost 100% of the population was employed at chemical plants. Industry production had strategic specifics. Chemical weapons were manufactured here, and personal protection from these weapons. Organic compounds for other industries, including optomechanical production. Several research institutes led developments in the field of polymers, chemical engineering, and production of explosives. But today, almost all of these enterprises are partially in or completely stopped. They continue to close even in recent years. Leadership wallowing in debts and is forced to start bankruptcy proceeds. Achieved activities continue in full force only on fully state-owned enterprises. You will need to spend every weekend for a few years to walk around the desolated territories. Only Soviet posters will remind that once people valued work in the name of their homeland and their birthplace, valued people ready to work. Do you think that it's only a problem of chemical industry? Of course it isn't. Let me show you something from machine industry and engineering. There is a lot of abandoned machinery plants both in Moscow and in other cities and towns. Machinery engineering took a great part of Soviet industry. But the dominance of imports caused decay of this branch of industrial progress too. And all the ex-USSR, except Belarus, you may see my enterprises equipped with modern hardware. And the other branch of industry is the textile industry. It was the other one which has come to downgrade. All the textile industry can be divided into producing of natural and chemical fiber. Factories of natural fiber started to appear as manufacturers as pre-revolutionary times and were active with Russia choose import textile as more proper than its own. In the Soviet era, they were upgraded, but nowadays most of them are abandoned. The technologies of producing chemical fiber developed in Europe while the Soviet Union was creating and constructing more and more chemical fiber plants. So now they can be met in many towns, but the most of them are stopped forever. When they could start to work, the technology had stepped away. If you are in Kursk, you may visit the Himvolokno plant. It's half abandoned. The part that was producing PET is stopped, and there was one part producing capron and nylon is alive. A competitor company has acquired this plant, but they had no plans for its future. Another branch. Metallurgy industry thrives in some regions, but some plants that were located in big cities are almost desolated. A few of them were located in Moscow. Now they are waiting for demolition. Another branch I'd love to talk to you about is the automobile industry. There were two plants in Moscow. One of them had name of SLK, and another one had name of ZIL. ZIL is demolition now. It is located on a half island of Moscow River, and the price for the territory on this place is very high. So they now are demolishing it for some offices, blocks of flats, and trade centers. But ZIL is a legend of Moscow. There are a lot of trucks called ZIL. They are used in many of industries in Russia. And I think the other plants of ZIL that are located all over the country will work for a few years producing some parts for these automobiles. And then, that's a pity, they will be destroyed too. Another theme of my speech is coal mining, but not in Ukraine, but in Moscow region. Some regions of ex-USSR are famous for coal mining, but very few people know that coal mining had a place near Moscow. The last mine in the central part of Russia was stopped in 2009. Construction of the mine number 89, East Grizlovskaya, began in 1967. According to the project, the mine was to become one of the largest in the Moscow coal basin. So during construction, it was decided to give a more grandiose name. In December of 1974, the mine was officially put into operation. In January of 1975, there was the first ton of coal mined. January 1975, ODO, the Minister of Coal Industry in the USSR, his name was Brashenko, renamed the mine to Podmoskovnaya. Podmoskovnaya means located in Moscow region. This name of a mine didn't occur anywhere else in the Soviet Union, and pointed to the fact that the mine should be flagship of the whole vast coal basin. Since 2006, the Podmoskovnaya was the only active coal mine, not only in the Tula region, but throughout the central economic region of Russia. Owner of the mine was Mosbasugal. In summer 2009, the mine was shut down. In the next few months, there was constructed pumping water. In February 2010, ran out of money to pay for electricity for water pumps. A few houses mine was flooded with all equipment. There was a lot of equipment. I was here and I saw it. There were some complexes for get the coil and to put it from underground to upside. Then a barbaric looting started from a chief engineer of the mine. Yuri Sasoyev, in a few days after the flooding of the mine, died of a heart attack. I knew him, and he was a great man. He spent all of his life for this mine, from 70 years as just a master of the mine to more than 80 years to master engineer. That system at Tulskaya region was a great, but I'd love to tell you about another one. It was located in Murmansk. It was Mika mine. You know that Mika can be get not everywhere in the world, but there was such place in Murmansk, in Murmansk region. Commercial deposits of high quality Mika was perfect crystals of large size, rare. Mining all these deposits was stopped in 1990s because of the cost of Mika purchased in India was below the cost of extraction here in Russia. You see, they produced some Mika in India and they decided that it's it's better to buy it from India than to produce it from our Murmansk region. And there are most of other mines in ex-USSR, but I can't tell about them because I have never been to its mines, only coal and Mika. And I hope that sometime I will visit them. But now I can talk about enterprises of different industries. But the industry is not possible without science. The decline of science is also widely observed in the former Soviet Union. The first speech today was about radio telescope, and I was a pity about the radio telescopes in Russia. Most of them are abandoned in different points of the central region. And this one, you look in the photo, is located near Nizhny Novgorod. Ground stations of space surveillance were actively built and developed in the late Soviet Union. Equally actively, they were left by researchers, was woke and gradually deprived of material and ideological motivation. Look at this. This station is located in Kharkov. Now it's Ukraine, but it's ex-USSR. This is a station of ionosphere observatory. It's almost abandoned, but looks great. According to official data, most of them are still functioning. In fact, the permanent working staff of these bases rarely exceeds the amount of a few irregularly operating employers. Oh, I saw there are about two or three man who were guarding that base, but we arrived to its fence. Look, nobody climbed over the fence and moved up to its top. Then we took some shots of the dish of that antenna, and no one has come to us. Then we moved down, walked to another part of the base. We have found a real dish. We climbed to the top of it, took again some shots, and then we walked down and saw a woman. He told us, he asked us, what are we doing there? And we told him that we are watching the base. She told us that it's guarded, and now she will call the police. It's located in Ukraine. While she was calling the police, we were running away from its base. when we ran away, we climbed over the fence again. There was a police car that asked for us, what are you doing there? And we answered, we are just walking and looking at the dish. And they answered us that everyone can look at the dish. And so we left the territory. Kharkov is a city that is located near near Russia, in Ukraine, but near Russia. And they often have some visitors from Russia and from Ukraine that try to climb to the top of it. I post the report about this base in my blog. A man has written to me. He told that this base is a leaf, but I saw it's rusty and it's abandoned totally. I think only one building can be alive in it. But he was sure that it's all alive. And he told to me that I can come every day and ask for him and have an excursion for this base. But I decided not to visit this base again, but because I thought that they can have different questions for me. That's the look of a typical abandoned scientific area. That's another radio telescope near Nizhny Novgorod. There were two bases of radio telescopes near Nizhny Novgorod. One of them is fine new, is Zimenki. But at Zimenki, there is only one dish that is just alive. Another ones were crushed for a metal, and they were took away. And the other one is near Arzamas. Arzamas is a town with its own history. There are some weapon base, some transport base, and scientific base. Scientific base has no military part. So the workers with there are about two or three workers. They are sure that this base is alive, but look at this housing. You look a wooden housing. I have sneak inside of it. It's destroyed, totally destroyed. And this dish doesn't work. Another one laboratory. New Moscow. Some of the abandoned laboratories are located underground. Oh, underground is my favorite laboratories because they are most I have the most interesting for them. Some of the abandoned laboratories are located underground. And they are most interesting. Oh. For example, this is one of laboratory for soil properties research. It's look like a field with some round areas on the surface. And on the ground there is three corridors with some devices that are looking for properties of soil. In this round parts of the area, there are different soils. And when it rains, the water comes through this rounds with different properties. Another one underground laboratory. It was used for studying of the influence of infrared radiation on materials and equipment. It's located near Moscow. It was abandoned about maybe 20 years ago. That's a particle accelerator, abandoned too. It's located near Moscow. It has three grounds underground, three floors underground. It was abandoned about 10 years ago. It's not ex-USSR abandonment. It was abandoned in it's the era of our minister of force, Serdyukov. Some branches of science have been almost completely abandoned, not only at regards of the individual effects. For example, the industry of studying and synthesis of materials, the industry of synthesis of materials had several bases on all over Moscow region, in Moscow and its region, but all of them are now abandoned. Look at this. It had some plants around of Moscow. Almost of them are abandoned. Some of them is in Arfaminsk. Some of them are in Yaroslavl. Yaroslavl is a center of other region, but there was a Moscow Institute of Minerals. Another one, science facility. Main research and military facilities have been designed on the sundown of the Soviet Union, and their construction was started. And the era of collapse, it's a great problem for our facilities. Some of them were really started at the era of collapse, and now they're abandoned. Some of them are military, some of them are science, some of them are industry. In military, there are a lot of bunkers that are located around from Moscow. But now no one will continue the construction. And some of them are located in ex-USSR countries as Belarus, Kazakhstan. But I think that their future is to be buried another one place. This is large slate booth, vertical. It's called vertical. It's located in St. Petersburg. It could be a large tower for laser experiments, for testing combat lasers. It's really, they tried to construct a complex for testing combat lasers, but it was started in the ending of 1990s years, and now looks like that. Another one complex near Moscow in Sergiev Posad. This huge building contains another great idea. There is a vacuum chamber for testing spacecraft parts and disciplines. You see, spacecraft parts, they were going to put it into some in some I'm sorry, but it's a pity. They're going to put some parts of spacecraft ships in some glass with a few grounds high, and there was a light that was like sunlight, and they were going to test these parts for its behavior in space, but it is also unfinished. It was unfinished at 90% of readiness. It's a great building with a great glass inside of it. Look, there are 1, 2, 3, 6 grounds of it. There is no person to compare with, but you may imagine the ground of it. It's huge, but now it's waiting for being destroyed for metal. And finally, one of the most popular underground sites of the Moscow region is the unfinished UNK. It means neutron collider, proton accelerator, and Protvino. The UNK proton accelerator was a large particle accelerator under construction in Protvino near Moscow, about 60 kilometers from Moscow to south. And the Institute of High Energy Physics were going to construct it, but they couldn't finish it because the USSR was collapsed. Well, progress in construction was announced in 1996 after the breakup of the Soviet Union and the economic change of the country. Government funding of the projects was halted, and only security and maintenance are funded now. It's a great tunnel underground. It has long of 21 kilometers. It's rounded. And now it's abandoned. They think that it's conserved, but I'm sure that it's abandoned. Work on the creation of the accelerator was started in 1983 for 11 years in a stable and dry rocks in a depth at a depth of 60 meters, depending on terrain. There is hilly terrain. The tunnel was built. It had diameter of 5 meters. You see, the round of 5 meters, and the round length of 21 kilometers. Throughout the tunnel, every 1.5 kilometers underground holes were built to accommodate large equipment, which were connected to the surface by vertical shafts. The vertical shaft is showed there. Ой, куда ты пошла? Куда? Почему назад? In 1994, he was commissioned in the first section of the new accelerator on a grand channel of 2 kilometers and 7,000 of meters, connecting the U-70 and the ESC. In the channel were mounted electromagnetic system, vacuum system, monitoring devices for beam. After setting all the elements of the channel, protons to 70 flew through the project trajectory until the insertion point of the future underground ring Unica. You see, they have constructed the first part of the accelerator. It was lined and it worked. But after completion of the main tunnel, tunneling work on the creation of the accelerator complex were completely halted due to the lack of funds. Currently, the primary tunnel is supported in caretaker status. There is emergency license ventilation systems, you see? Oh, it looks like this now. For a variety of reasons, completely revive the Soviet collider is impossible. But there is an idea to put in an underground ring tunnel giant battery, which helped to maintain an overload power grid in the Moscow region. But now it's just a huge crude underground tunnel which lighted areas and array outcrops. People who were interested destroyed factories, abandoned facilities, and studied the histories of industry and theory and practice, who got into forbidden territories personally or in groups, infiltrated into sealed buildings, climbed over concrete fences with barbed wire, and up rooftops or some high constructions to take shots or videos. They called themselves urban explorers. My name is Lana Sator, and I'm happy to be one of them. Thank you for listening.
Thank you.
So, thank you very much for this very cool presentation and coming all the way from Moscow for this. Oh, you can keep this. Please keep it because there are questions now. yes.
Okay.
This was Lana's first conference, I think, and even first time outside of Moscow. So that was pretty cool. Very nice for her to come. So, yep.
Are actually all the photos that you've taken from prohibited areas? So is it all illegal or? Like, do you have to break into the areas to take the photos or?
Some of these areas opened, but a lot of them are closed and we need to sneak into them to take these photos. I don't want
other questions.
I don't know what to answer to you.
Other questions?
Do you think you could help us to get into the accelerator here?
I'm not going to sneak into the accelerator here, but I hope that someone will show it to me.
How do you actually climb over those barbed wire fences? What kind of equipment and techniques do you need? Just out of pure theoretical curiosity.
I need no equipment to climb over them, only my hands and my legs. But some fences are so hard that I prefer not to climb over them, but look for another way to sneak into. There are always some tunnels underground with cables or drains or sewers that can be walked through.
Any other questions?
Oh.
Lots of questions.
I have a question concerning the overall technology that you studied. Given that it was produced in a planned economy rather than market economy, do you think that there are any specific differences between this ex-USSR technology and any equivalent in, I don't know, in Europe or in the US?
There are a lot of differences between Russian market and the European market because our market is looking for some ways with import and export. They don't use their own fuel. They produce oil, then sell it, then they buy petrol. And in Europe, they produce oil, produce petrol, and use it. There is a difference. Not only in oil, but in some other products of industries.
Have you been to all these places yourself? And if so, how much time did it take?
I mean,
you have been doing this for years, I guess.
I have showed to you only the places I have been visited them myself. I have some photos from other places that I have never been to. But I prepared the speech with places that I saw myself. And it took about from a few days to a few weeks. They are located in different parts of Moscow region and some other regions. I have told to you not about all the places I have visited. Some of them are located far from Moscow, in some 1,000 kilometers, maybe in Novosibirsk, Khabarovsk, Vladivostok. But I think that I will visit some places in Europe and maybe America sometime. And it will take me some days or some weeks.
How careful do you have to be when it comes to hazardous materials like chemical spills or radioactive byproducts or some biological experiments that are just gone haywire when everything got abandoned? So how dangerous is it for your health?
Some people think that it's rather dangerous, but I think that dangerous can be only radioactive places or some chemical plants. So in radioactive places, I use individual dosimeter. And in chemical plants, I sometimes use mask for my face, and I try to spend a few time there to run away from it.
Спасибо большое, надо Клара. Одна вопрос: как вы находите такие места? Хочу повторить по-английски.
I can't see you.
How you find these places?
Okay,
I think there are no lists on addresses or something else.
Oh, the addresses of them. It's a mechanism for finding them. Some of abandoned facilities are found by using some rent websites. They post some information about renting for industries, and we see him and visit them. But there is a large urban explorers community in Russia, and we often use the information of other regions and our colleagues.
Did you visit certain places more than once to see how they deteriorate over time?
Did
you go to one and the same place after a certain time, for example, after a year? You visited the first time,
of course,
and did you see how the deterioration progresses over time?
Of course, sometimes we visit the same times in a month or a couple of months or a year, and see the difference between the condition of it, and it's always a poor sight. They destroy it for metal, for territory, and entropy destroys our places.
Other questions? Well, thanks again for this amazing presentation and answering all those questions.
Thank you.